All right. Well, welcome, Anthony. Thank you so much for joining me today here on Leftist and Chill. We've invited you here in the spirit of building leftist unity, strength, and power. And in the same spirit, we appreciate your willingness to join us today, talk to us about your story, your life a little bit. Maybe we'll do the leftist inquisition questionnaire. We'll have some fun with that, have some time for questions from you at the end. And maybe if we have questions, we'll talk about what's grinding your gears. How you doing today, bud? What's going on?
Oh, not bad. Just hanging out, enjoying my Sunday. Usually is my chill out day. You know, work all week and then, you know, do the stream most of the time at night. So,
yeah. Well, cool. Let's talk about that. Before we talk a little bit about your stream, tell folks, you know, in this "Where Are They Now" category, you know, what's your story? Where can people find you? And what do you do?
I'm on Twitter at _20Westside. I'm mostly active on there. What I do and everything other than this, I mean, I'm an accountant, so okay. I do a bunch of finance stuff when I'm not doing streaming. So, yeah. I'm a lot more capitalist in my professional life than I probably am in my philosophy.
All right. Well, you're canceled. And so it's been a nice... It's been a nice chat. So, show's over.
But I will say I'm more capitalist out of necessity.
Well, okay, we'll allow it then. In that case, yeah. No problem. Cool. So, Anthony, you do the Unelectable Airwaves podcast. We've had DJ Tom Hanks on, the other half, half of the show, if that's okay. wait, you don't say that? Did I just make that up? Oh, shit.
Matt's definitely the more edgy one of both of us. You know, I kind of am more like the straight man, and he's more he comes with the hot takes and on a number of stuff. So
wait, I thought you got into the UFO stuff, or is that him?
That's Matt. That's Matt loves the UFO stuff. I try to get him into the ghost stuff. You know, I like to show him the crap. But I guess ghosts are too crazy for him. You know, you're talking about aliens and abductions and all that other different stuff. You know, that's cool. But, you know, once we start getting into the paranormal, they cross the line somewhere.
Right. But you ground him. You ground him.
Yeah. I mean, I try to as much as I can. You know, there has to be a little bit of balance.
Yeah.
Of course, you know.
Right.
The hot good takes are still good.
Good and evil.
Exactly. There you go.
Sorry, I don't mean to walk over you there. Yeah. Love it.
Yeah. But it's cool. He was actually, when I was volunteering for Bernie, he was my direct like moderator, supervisor, person. Really? Right. Yeah. Okay. So when, I started volunteering on that site, I got into the events team, and Matt, I guess, was assigned to call everybody that's getting recruited in. So he calls me, and it's supposed to be like a brief 5-minute conversation. We end up talking for like 3 hours about all the lefty tubers and a bunch of, you know, this and that. And we had a rapport and we hit it off. And then somewhere in the middle of all that, he tells me, yo, like, do you want to do a podcast? And I'm like, all right. Yeah, I guess we can try that. Let's go hit a podcast. And then he got us on iTunes. We were just using, like you said, like Skype to record audio and post up on Anchor and stuff like that. And then I said, you know, we got to do video. We got to do some stuff on there. And been building up that thing for like the better part of a year. And got to shout you out, of course, bro, because you helped us upgrade the whole scenery up on our stream after I tried my hand at doing a bunch of different stuff and dropping about 40 a month on that pay service, bro. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a little bit of a pain in the ass to be paying up.
Yeah. Stream yards. Is that what they call that? Yeah.
It was called Ecamm.
Oh, Ecamm. Ecamm. Yeah, you're the one Ecamm guy out there.
Yeah, I was the one Ecamm guy.
I think you kept them afloat. Yeah. Otherwise I think they probably just like fucking shut their doors. Like, well, our client's gone.
If it wasn't for the price of that thing, it'd be really worth it because I mean they charge you $40 and you get to stream natively like if you're calling into Skype. You know, and like that was like amazing to me. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it's all that user interface is what you pay for. So, but.
All right. What else? I don't know. Do you have like hobbies? that I haven't heard about? Like, what keeps you busy, dude?
Well, I like to. Yeah, I'm gonna out myself as a complete nerd by saying I like to spend all my time studying chess and stuff like that. I'm not all that great, but no. I still like to study it. I like to play games all those time. I play PS4 here and there too. I'm not as big into it as I used to be. I used to be a real hardcore Madden player.
Yeah.
I'm talking about like hardcore Madden player. Like I would wake up at like 6 a.m, go to sleep like at 12 and play all day and bet money and all that. Yeah.
Wow.
I was ranked for Madden. Madden 12 is where I cut it off. I was ranked in the top 15 in the
Holy
world.
Holy shit, dude. Holy fuck.
Yeah. It was actually like I retired from the game because it was too much with the betting money, and you know, you gain $2,000, you lose $2,000, you know, all this other different crap. You know, it's just too much of a roller coaster. So I completely stepped back from the game. And another thing about me, I went to law school up in New York. So I'm from Texas and El Paso, and I moved up to New York to go to law school. When I did that, the nice family that took me in up there, one of my best friends up there now, he was big into Madden, and he would beat everybody in the house that his mom would rent to. So one day he decides to go and he's going to play me. And he's like, "You play Madden?" And I'm like, "Oh, you know, a little bit."
A little bit.
Yeah. So I end up beating him like 80-0 three times in a row. And then they're like, "Who are you?"
You didn't bet him, did you?
No, I didn't do that. I'm not gonna hustle. I'm not gonna hustle anybody.
Madden
like
shark
that.
Him.
No, I'm not gonna do that. I'm not gonna do that to people. But if you know, if they're wanting to go ahead and just play, I mean, I still got some stuff that I can do. Even the playbooks change and all that crap, I can still play.
Do you like? You know, give them a little trash talk to try to rile them up, and then like just own their ass.
Well, I kind of feel like I gave that up when I was that hardcore player because. Like this is what I would literally do. I would play all damn day, and then I would go into the chat rooms in the Madden lobby, and I'd be like, "Who else wants some Adebo?" Some bullshit like that, and I'd wreck people, and then they'd come back and be like, "Don't play that guy. Nah, he's too good. Don't play that guy." And I'm like, "Oh god,
what a life, dude. This is fascinating." Yeah. Okay, so now we could talk then, Anthony, about your leftward bound journey. Time here. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, bro, this is gonna be fun.
All right, well, hold on. Let me intro. We're gonna talk about your pathway to leftism. You don't have to define your ideology if you don't want to, Anthony. If you're comfortable doing so, we do encourage it. Otherwise, let's start the leftward bound discussion there and see where we go.
Mm. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, bud.
All right, sounds good. Let's see. Well, I mean, I kind of consider myself a sock dem, I guess. Like, so I'm internationally, I'm probably a moderate. I'm way more to the right of Matt. Okay. So that's kind of part of that balancing out thing. But I think I've always kind of, you know, well, I was really very much a lib for most of the time that I would be active in politics in any kind of meaningful way as far as voting or activism or anything like that. Growing up in Texas, I don't know if it is just like kind of the way the education system is oriented here, but I kind of grew up more like even believing like the Republicans and conservatism before I kind of, you know, had my way of thinking like, oh, okay, wait a minute. That doesn't make a lot of sense. All right. I don't like the way they talk. These people are psycho. They're like, okay, yeah, I can't be a Republican. I'm not a Republican. And then, yeah, when I became more of a lib and everything, I would watch all the cable news stuff because that's kind of like the only politically interested person was my aunt, and she watches MSNBC to this day religiously, and that's kind of what I caught on to doing. Mm-hmm. And then 2016 happened, and yeah, I was a Hillary supporter at the time. And well, after 2016, I kept seeing all the people like in my lib circle still kind of shit-talking Bernie, and I'm like, Bernie sucked it up and went hardcore to try to get Hillary elected. Why are we still talking shit about this dude? Like every time he says he's going to show up for something, he shows up for something, you know, and he actually sticks by things that he believes in. And then from there, it became like, all right, yeah, I should have been supporting Bernie. Okay, yeah, what's all this lefty stuff about? Okay, yeah, well, who are all these nice lefty YouTubers that seem much more intelligent than the people I watch on TV? Okay, yeah, and then I'm done with being a lib. So that's kind of my trek into leftwardness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, we build a show as being open to leftist and left adjacent folks, you know? I got to be open to some folks that are not necessarily leftist. And, and no, this is great. And it's good to have you here in that respect specifically. Yeah. Well, what else? Anything else along your way that, excuse me. Yeah, anything else along the way there, Anthony, in terms of politics or history, your own personal experiences, et cetera, that helped pull your mind and heart or anything specific along the way?
I've always been a really big history nerd, so that's kind of the thing that I've spent a lot of time studying history, different eras. All the kind of U.S. history has always been like my focus and stuff. And, you know, growing up, they teach you about American exceptionalism. In Texas, they teach you about Texan exceptionalism too. And they kind of gloss over the whole fact. It was kind of a reverse civil war where, you know, you had a rebellion against the Mexicans to go ahead and retain ownership of slavery and stuff, or at least partial of it. You know, it's a lot of romanticism of, you know, we're talking about like Alamo Defenders and Sam Houston and San Jacinto and all the kind of different stuff during the Texas Revolution and the whole idea of Texas as an independent country. And then that goes and plays into the whole, you know, manifest destiny is a good thing, when you learn about it in history, in history classes and that kind of stuff. And, I really didn't really get shaken about any of that kind of stuff until after I had like a whole conversion to move further left in my political life to go ahead and reevaluate all the stuff that I've been studying about. Like, how, I mean, you have to kind of look at it. It changes your whole worldview once you start analyzing things from those perspectives.
Yeah. Cool. Anything else specifically along the way you want to point at? I love the idea of Texan exceptionalism. That cracks me.
It's a real thing. Because all the stuff during the Texas Revolution has all those different little stories and all the, you know, the martyrdom of the defenders of the Alamo. You know, oh, there were 200 Texans fending off several thousand Mexicans, and they all got butchered and burned overnight, and they were trying to do so for freedom. Not, you know, just their freedom, not everybody else's. But.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely, dude. Texceptionalism. I'm dying over here. Yikes. Okay, well, we have plenty of time. I feel like we're plowing through. So feel free to, like, dig in and elaborate any chance you get, any chance you want to. Oh, boy. So now we can look back a little bit here at, you know, your current projects, what you do on the Unelectable Airwaves show. Did you want any more time to chat about, you know, a typical episode of what your show is like?
Yeah, for sure. Well, we're on most nights. And really, we try to divide the show into two halves, where the first half we talk mainly about politics, your current events, whatever happens to be trending or going on, whatever the conversation's about, we'll probably do at least part of the first half of the show on it. The second half, like you kind of alluded to, you kind of go off the rails. We just go and talk about whatever else is on our mind. So we'll talk about the UFO stuff. We'll go deep into conspiracy. We did, for a while we were doing like creature features about like sightings and stuff of different cryptids, as they're called. That was a lot of fun. Like, oh, you know, we saw some kind of like chupacabra out there in the middle of the freaking campsite, or there was this one really good one. I mean, if it was digital, they did a really good job on it where there was some kind of like red-eyed beast in the woods while these guys were camping, and then they got so freaked out they jumped in the lake, and then you can see the thing kind of hunched up on the cliff and it jumped in after them. it's a really good video to, and that one actually had Matt shook up a little bit. But so most of the time, that's what we will do on our show. We'll start with some kind of, you know, serious, more serious political kind of conversation, and then we'll then talk about anything under the sun in the second half. We really narrow it down to one thing or another. But the last, or at least not this past stream, the stream before, we spent most of it just watching the Richard Wolf and Destiny debate.
Yeah,
that was great. Yeah, Matt had seen it before me, and he was all like, "Oh, you got to see this. This is great. You're gonna like." And then I was kind of like, "All right, look, it's another one of these debates, and I don't like seeing these damn debate bros. Yeah. I hate the debate bros."
Yeah,
I mean, if not for nothing else, it's for the pretentiousness. But when I knew a little bit more about Professor Wolf because I had seen a few of his videos, and I see him again on a couple of streams, and it's like, all right, I like seeing him talk. So maybe I'll get through this whole debate idea just by hearing him talk and focusing on what he says. And man, actually, I was watching it again, and David Dole was re-airing it on his channel. He said the same thing I did. It was less of a debate and more of a lecture in which, you know, Professor Wolf was the guest speaker.
Yeah, and then they let this like little chud boy just interrupt every now and then.
Yeah, exactly.
And then it's like, okay, Mr. Wolf, continue your lecture. Yes, exactly. Dr. Wolf.
Yeah, exactly, man. It was kind of like being back in one of my con law classes. So like where I went to law school was in Long Island. So you end up with a bunch of like right wingers in class. And then where it really comes out is in con law, because you have distinct philosophies when it comes to analyzing the Constitution, whether you think it's an organic document, where you believe in strict interpretation, metaphysical reading of the founding fathers' minds. And when it comes to those real divisive issues, that's where those conversations come up. And in that class, I had a teacher that was more of a lib, and then all those conservative students that would kind of chime in here and then. So here I am trying to listen to the professor, knows what she's talking about, been a lawyer for whatever else, and studied con law for years. And then all of a sudden you see somebody chime in with their stupid conservative talking point, and it was like, okay, dude, I don't need that. I don't need that. But I'll say it was fun when they kind of let the students kind of argue amongst each other.
Yeah.
Which I think is probably the more entertaining way to watch Destiny. You know, get somebody that isn't as well-rounded as Professor Wolf on a debate topic, and then maybe it'll actually be worth watching if you're into that kind of thing.
That debate was great in the sense that it was terrible. You're right. No, it was entirely entertaining to watch.
Yeah, and I mean, I knew what he was trying to do. When you're debating somebody, you're used to debating somebody that doesn't know what they're talking about. You tell them to go and talk more about the thing that they want to talk about. You tell them to explain points and define things. And if they don't know what they're talking about, they look foolish. Mm-hmm. But if you do that to someone like Professor Wolf, then you look foolish by just having him go and lecture you. And then get mad when he goes and lectures you and gives you very clear-cut examples of why you're wrong.
Dude, if I saw Destiny do this like one more time, I would die. He keeps doing this. He just keeps like, "Nyeh." I'm like, Destiny, how can you literally telegraph to people more that you're losing this debate? "Nyeh." I'm like, dude, relax.
The Matt Cowdy face is just a dead giveaway, bro. You don't gotta
Dude. You were losing this debate. Yeah. All right. So now, Anthony, now we can move along. Right. The next category is hashtag be best. And this is where I ask you to take your entire life as if it were a wet rag and wring it out. And you know what? What wisdom and goodness comes out? What would you share with a younger version of yourself? Or
well, okay, so when I was younger and everything, I kind of bounced around with what I wanted to do. I went to a high school that was oriented to gear you towards the medical field. My mom was a nurse, so I kind of always was geared in that direction. And that's kind of how I set up into, after high school, going into college to, I was wanting to be like a pharmacy tech or some shit like that. And after that, that didn't really work out. I hated the job and I needed to completely reevaluate what I was going to do after high school. And I had no idea. And, you know, I knew I was good at a bunch of different things. Like I could catch on to doing, you know, history, philosophy was one of my best classes. And then I was really good in math. So I could do what I ended up doing was accounting. Right. And if I could go back and tell my younger self something, I would say you got to do what you're good at, because, and you're going to find that there's avenues for you in what you are good at. Because for me, if I could go back and do all my college years again, I would have gone straight into just studying history or philosophy and then done the same thing, gone out to New York and gone to law school. I would have saved myself about, I'm not even sure, more years than I'm comfortable saying that it took me to get a 4-year degree.
4 years is a different amount of time for some people.
Oh,
I can relate. So do what you're good at. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I said. Stick to what you're good at. It's a really good way to evaluate what you should put your focus and what your energy is into. You know, like I'm always been kind of interested in talking about politics. So I kind of steer into this kid. Go ahead, talk about politics. Find a mean to be able to talk about it. You know, and when it came to, you know, the legal stuff, I always kind of liked the legal stuff. So, you know, study the legal stuff, study history, study, you know, study the stuff you're good at, because you have more choices when you're in education like that. You know, it's weird, the mindset that you go from high school to college, because in high school, everything is told to you. You got to study this. You have to study this. You have to study this. This is what everybody has to study. And in college, it's kind of all on you. You decide what you want to do. You can pick any number of majors. You know, how best can you start making a living for yourself? That's really what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, and yeah, that's kind of what I come to the conclusion of. You'll find a way to be able to make a living if you stick to what you're good at.
Stick to what you're good at. That's what he said. Love it, Anthony. That's excellent advice. I think that'll really hit the spot for a lot of people. Hey, let's continue. This brings us to the leftist inquisition, the questionnaire. Yeah, everyone loves it. No one hates it.
All right.
Skip or pass any question.
All right.
And I won't take it personally. Do you have a favorite word?
A favorite word, colloquial.
Colloquial, yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
Wait, say it again.
Colloquial.
It's your favorite word?
I like that. I mean, that's the way I pronounce it. Maybe it's the wrong way.
Say it again.
Isn't it colloquial?
Nah.
No? Colloquial?
I think so. I could be wrong.
I don't know, because I always thought QU was like more of a k. No? Maybe it's an accent.
The thing is this, I don't decide how words are, good word though, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I just don't like the way it kind of rolls.
Maybe that's... Do you have a least favorite word? I got to go on.
Least favorite word. All right, let's go. Least favorite word. All right, brother.
Yeah. What was it?
His favorite word, I'm just going to pass on that one. I have to think about that one.
Yeah, no, it's a shitty question. Squish. Squish. Like squish, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
All right. Anthony, do you have a favorite drug, a favorite vice, a favorite guilty pleasure, or you can name one of each?
Okay, favorite drug, or I'm not going to lie, I do like taking acid trips whenever I can. Vices. I kind of consider this a vice, but I really shouldn't do is like when I drink on stream. Yeah, I probably shouldn't do it too much, but
why is
it's
that?
We're on late at night. It seems like, you know, maybe I should still have some kind of dose of professionalism.
It's unprofessional.
There you go. You're making me feel better about it, bro. I'm going to tell you that it is really helping me out.
My thing is, like, I want this show to sort of feel like we're sitting down and having a beer with each other and just chit-chatting about dumb shit, you know?
You see, there we go. And you know what? You know what got on my head? My mom sometimes has seen when I stream and she keeps telling me stuff, but maybe that's just because she's a mom. And that's why she's telling me I shouldn't do stuff like that.
All right. Well, that's why you feel guilty about it.
There you go.
All right.
See? Makes sense.
Yeah. All right. Maybe you shouldn't. But that's, I don't know. Maybe you should. I don't know. I don't know how much you drink. So now I'm like, I don't know what I'm encouraging. You drink the whole thing? You drink some scotch?
I'm not gonna drink the whole thing. That's $100 scotch. What am I going to do?
I don't know how much you make. You're an accountant. You count other people's money for them, which means they can't count their money.
Yeah, but I have ethics and principles, and I'm also more left-leaning, so, you know, I try to instill things into my CEO, like, you know, have some kind of worker ownership into the company, allocate some kind of, you know, stock portfolio.
You can take worker ownership into your own hands.
There you go. See? That's what I kind of gear myself towards.
Beautiful. All right, moving on then. We're moving on to sounds and noises. Is there one that you love?
Sound or noise? Sound or noise that I love? I'm not quite sure how to answer that one.
I know, it's a dumb question.
Sound or noise? Would you have a sound or noise?
I don't know.
You know what I do, actually? You know,
yeah.
I do get a little bit more relaxed when I hear like raindrops falling and stuff like that, man.
Raindrops, that's nice.
Yeah, I even got myself one of them rainfall shower heads and all that. Yeah, I mean, it's just relaxing to me. What can I tell you?
Nice. Wait, do you just turn the shower on in the background and listen to it?
No. Now I got one of them Google Home devices, and at night you can put a routine, and then it'll play like certain relaxing sounds, and one of the relaxing sounds is raindrops.
Oh, that's a nice, it just plays it for you. You don't have to turn it on anymore. That's a smart idea. I didn't think of that.
Yeah.
All right. I like that idea. I might actually set up a routine. I usually fall asleep first in my bedroom. Okay. A sound or noise that you don't like, or you?
Oh, I got this one.
Oh.
Okay. You know that styrofoam stuff that's in a box when you unpack it?
Yeah.
I hate the sound of it scraping.
I know.
Yeah, that one does get me. Terrible.
People mention this one a lot, so yeah, it's terrible. Yeah.
It's bad, man. It's bad.
Really bad. You're absolutely right. You're right about that one. Now you said you grew up in Texas, right?
Yep.
Okay, that's not France or Wisconsin. So you get one answer to this question. What's your favorite cheese?
Favorite cheese, Gorgonzola.
Ooh, Gorgonzola. First time I've heard that answer on the show. Gorgonzola. Yep. What do you like about Gorgonzola?
Man, I just like it has more of that pungent flavor. Throw some of that Grey Poupon on there and a croissant. Ooh. There you go.
Ooh. Love it. Yep. Snack man.
Yeah, I do like my snacks. I like to cook a little bit.
Yeah.
And like now I just moved up into my new house, right? Like I told you before. So I have like a full on open kitchen, and I've been cooking on nonstop for like the last few weeks. Been able to save money too, so that's good.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
Got myself one of them cast iron skillets.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah, been cooking up all kinds of good stuff. Had myself a T-bone last night. That was great.
That's cool. I'm not into cooking, but it's good to have friends that are, right? You know what I mean? We'll have to come visit and you can cook for me.
You know, it's good for my, you know, when you ask a girl up on a date and you can always throw that one out there.
Yeah, they love it. I've been told. So, all right, moving on. Oh, reincarnation. If you had the choice to come back as a plant or a non-human animal, what would you choose?
Plant or an animal, non-human animal.
Yeah.
Like, can I live in any era?
Sure.
Well, because, I mean, I would want to be like some kind of dinosaur.
Ooh, nice, yeah.
Yeah,
probably. Yeah, you don't want to be like a dinosaur now. You'd be like, a little bit out of place.
A little bit off place, yeah. I mean, I probably want to be a I'm not sure exactly how you pronounce it now because you shook my whole
world. Oh my God. But I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I wish I could take it back.
But called the Deinonychus.
Okay.
They're the ones that look like a velociraptor in Jurassic Park.
Oh.
See, the movies made one look like a different dinosaur because they're more physically imposing because the velociraptor was basically a little chicken.
Oh. But very angry chickens.
Yeah.
Kind of. I love Jurassic Park. I saw it 14 times in the theater when I was a kid. I got on my bike and I rode to the theater like every fucking day that summer. Well, 14 times, I guess.
Yeah, man. I had the old VHS tape. I had back in the day, you used to be able to record stuff that was on TV on a video cassette. So I did that with Lost World. So I grew up a pretty big dinosaur nerd. I even wrote like short stories with dinosaurs. And yeah, I'm talking about when I was like 5 or 6, dude. So it's not going to be that impressive. But still, I mean, 20 pages for a 6-year-old, I'm okay.
That's insane. We're going to have to return to that. Anthony, we're planting seeds. I'm going to have you back on sometime, but we're going to return to that. Make sure you bring some of your pros, your dinosaur pros.
Okay. Yeah. You know, I'll have to put something else together then.
All right. How about the God question? If you went to heaven and there was God, what would you want them to say?
Man, heaven and God exist. We hear them. Let's see.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess I kind of want to get some kind of validation that, you know, I live my life right and stuff like that. I mean, that's kind of what God's supposed to be, the ultimate moral authority. So be like, all right, you know what? By and large, you did good for yourself. You know, you did some bad things, did some good stuff, but you know what? You've earned your spot. You're good.
That would be convincing for you.
I mean, it's God, right? So you're assuming that, you know, if anything you learned about God, that he's the ultimate moral authority, then he's going to be able to tell you that for sure.
Okay.
And,
all right.
You know, there's not.
Yeah.
I'm like trying to think about it. It's kind of a odd, what do you call it? Dynamic, because you're not, you know, the way you kind of live your life is that, you know, we're all on the same playing field, right? We're all humans. We're all people making the same kind of errors and all that sort of thing. But, you know, if you're talking about a deity that's supposed to be, all-knowing, omniscient, and all that kind of stuff, then you could tell you stuff that you wouldn't be able to get from anybody else.
All right.
I grew up in going to Catholic school, by the way.
Yeah. I was lucky to avoid it.
Kinder through 8th grade, bro.
Yeah? Wow. Yep. Real talk.
Mm-hmm.
Are you a believer now?
It's a weird kind of thing because it's like, you know, you want to kind of believe because that's what you grew up believing. And like you know, if you believe in any kind of spirituality, then, you know, there's a place for God within your belief system and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, I mean, I guess I'm kind of in the middle ground. I mean, I try to take like the positives away from what I learned in religion and try to apply it to my life, because more than that, that's kind of a more important question than whether or not God or spirits or angels exist. It's more about how can you contribute the most positivity to your life and the people around you. You know, so
yeah.
Because then, what are you going to do? You're going to be wondering about God existing your whole life and then just spend your whole life waiting to die? Doesn't make a lot of sense.
Okay. All right. Then, Anthony, name an influential leftist, and they could be dead or alive, and you could define leftist any way you like. An influential leftist you'd like to meet.
I'd like to meet, I would have loved to meet Michael Brooks. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Rest in power. That would have
been, yeah. I would really like to meet Professor Wolf now. I mean, after seeing especially after seeing the whole debate thing with Destiny, I mean, I just like to see a debate, bro, get owned like that. And I mean, any of these dudes that I regularly watch up on YouTube too are great, man. So I would be down to go ahead and just, you know, smoke a bowl or whatever else with any of these dudes.
Okay. Now you can take any of these people and stick them in your mind for this next question, where you have a hypothetical conversation that can go any way you like. How would that hypothetical conversation go? What do you think they might say? What maybe you have something you would ask them? Maybe you wonder what they would think about you or the world. I don't know. Or something else.
And I guess any of the people that I, you know, watch and all that kind of stuff, I think most of the points and stuff we would probably agree with, because I mean, my political worldview is in part shaped by their information and what they do for themselves. So, I mean, not for nothing else though. I mean, like, there's, of course, you don't 100% agree with everybody. So, I mean, I just kind of, would want them kind of taking away that I have interesting things to, for them to think about as well.
Hey, great. That's fascinating. All right, buddy. Then this takes us to, I think I got a couple more then. Oh yeah. Do you have a favorite leftist book?
Yeah, I can't really think of one that comes to mind. That's like, yeah.
All right. We come back to that next time we talk. It doesn't matter.
Yep.
Never. Maybe we don't, and it doesn't matter. All right. So, Anthony, you're a streamer.
Yes.
You stream yourself. You've been doing it a good while. You have a good grasp of a couple different ways of streaming, actually, which it actually gives you good sort of a good way of looking at things. And then also, you watch streams, and you know, well, I don't know what streamer tips do you have for beginners or veterans?
Well, I think for anybody looking to go ahead and start out on their stuff, then first thing you have to do is contact Dan to help you do your stuff. Well, not for nothing, but yeah, that would really help you. But no, I mean, like, the main thing I would say is, you know, you have to start with something that you really want to go ahead and say, and you have to stay committed to doing it. You know, it's for most anybody that goes out there and streams. If you don't already have some kind of major following on some kind of platform by some kind of means, it's going to be a grind. You're going to start off talking with yourself. If you're lucky enough to get somebody good to stream with, like I did, you're going to end up just having a conversation with you and your homie. That's all it's going to end up being. And you got to be cool with that. You got to be cool with not having anybody in the chat for a while. You got to be cool with not seeing any kind of money streaming, and don't stream because you're looking to get money quick. That's not a good plan to have, you know. And figure out what kind of look you want to have, you know, what kind of appearance, what kind of vibe you want to have when you're streaming, what kind of environment you're trying to set up. You know, you want to have more of like a laid back kind of thing. You want to be more buttoned up. You got to figure out what you want to be early on, and then stick to one way of doing it. Like I said, you know, play into what you're good at.
Anthony, excellent advice right there. Really good stuff. Well, I guess that brings us to the end of my questions for the questionnaire.
Awesome.
Now you get to ask me questions. You get to take questions from the chat. We are talking right now with Anthony Gonzalez, one half of the Unelectable Airwaves. We had DJ Tom Hanks on a week or two ago, and now we're chatting today with Anthony. What do you think, buddy?
All right, yeah. Anybody has anything want to ask me, it's cool.
Yeah. Otherwise, we have plenty of time to ask you what's grinding your gears, and we could just sort of go at it. What do I want to say? Just on the fly.
See, grinding my gears, current event stuff. I mean, like, the thing that I guess we've been bouncing around talking a bunch about here and there was all the AOC stuff with Biden has exceeded our expectations and stuff. That's I mean, most of the time, I'm going to agree with AOC on what she says. With the rhetoric that completely diverges because I feel she says way too much stuff to try to go along to get along if they have any kind of popularity among Democrats, especially that's just kind of what she does. And this whole thing, like I looked at the whole thing for context and all that stuff with the town hall, and I mean, it's not what anybody wants to fucking hear when you've already seen Biden back up from 2K, back up from minimum wage, back up from student debt relief, you know, bomb Syria, you know, what have you. And then she herself had to go ahead and say something when it came to Biden upholding the immigration policy from the Trump era. So unless she's trying to say our expectations were so far in the basement that the fact that, you know, we're still in one piece in most part and COVID's gotten marginally better. Yeah, I don't know what business she has saying that, really. Yeah, exactly. More kids in cages than ever. Like, I mean, she had to go and say something about that. You know, it's like, what are you talking about? Where were your expectations if Biden's exceeded them? I mean, trying to give like a good faith reading, like Matt tried to do this last night too, when we were talking about, but he said that, well, maybe she's getting to be part of some conversations on infrastructure bills that she didn't think she'd be able to get a part of. Maybe some stuff is happening behind the scenes. And look, if that's the case, if she's actually getting to be in the room when all the fucking major decisions are getting made and all a bunch of stuff is happening that we're not seeing, and she's actually doing stuff to get good policy accomplished, then okay, fine. You know what? I don't need to see shit behind the scenes. I don't need to have her out there talking shit if she's actually getting something done. But, you know, barring that and unable to go ahead and see anything to the contrary, you have to kind of just read into what you're left reading into what she says and her rhetoric more. So I can understand people's frustration.
I don't have anything to add. I don't think my question would just be like, how would we know if she was doing stuff behind the scenes? We wouldn't know.
You wouldn't, you know, the only thing you would know at the end of the day is, okay, there's, you look at the next infrastructure bill and be like, oh, that looks a little bit progressive. That's probably what she was trying to get, you know. But even then, at that point, it's just conjecture and it's all speculation at that point too.
It's almost a poison pill if she like takes credit for anything that's in there.
Yeah.
Because then that's fodder for the Fox News.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, that's kind of what they'll do anyway. So if they see something that's slightly leaning left at all in any of these bills, are going to be like, oh, AOC has complete control of Joe Biden. See that? The Democratic Party is a slave to Bernie and AOC. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, yeah, I'm sure.
And we still have time for questions from the chat, by the way. I'll just throw that out there. Cool.
That's a good point, actually, too. Like, the main reason that we voted for Biden was to get rid of Trump. We knew he wouldn't do anything real for us. And, I mean, I guess that's a good point, though. I mean, now that we have, like, a little bit of more perspective, I mean, was harm reduction, I guess, did that really work to our benefit? I mean, how much better off are we now that Trump is out compared to Biden? You know, I mean, what would have actually have been changed under his administration after a second administration? I mean, it was more about shit that would piss us off. I mean, I feel like most of the things that the libs say were reasons that Trump needed to go was just shit that he said was uncouth and beyond the pale. All that kind of stuff. The things that piss us off about Trump, policy-wise, I mean, are really not that far apart from Biden on most respects.
Right. Right. Couple wins, though. You know,
yeah.
He's, despite, I think, deporting more people to Haiti in his first 100 days than mm-hmm. Trump has had in all of 2020. I think that's a stat. I do believe there are some deportations. I believe that I remember having read AOC referenced. So, you know, we can't say it's all bad. You know what I mean? Otherwise, mm-hmm. Otherwise, we're sort of saying these people don't exist.
Yeah.
Because they're still here and they haven't been deported. That said, yeah, way fucking tons of room to grow. And,
Yeah. And I mean, like, the thing that kind of that has my thoughts more is since Biden did win and defeat Trump and everything, does that kind of embolden the liberal establishment thinking that they don't need to make meaningful change because their guy won, the institutions held up, they were able to defeat the insurgent campaign, and we could just continue doing things that we want to do to go ahead and continue the system of enrichment, you know? And I don't know. That's kind of why I was saying that, you know, we're going to end up having some kind of challenge to Kamala down the line. Because, I mean, I'm 50-50 Biden's going to make it out of his first term. Sorry. I'm just being real. Just being real. Dude. Okay, I don't want to get you, like, I don't get you a show for your stream.
There's no way close to TOS. Keep going.
Well,
keep digging down, Anthony. This is great content.
Well, all I would say is that, like, if we got an announcement by 5 o'clock today that our dear president was no more, I would not be surprised. I don't think I would really, you know, have like any kind of moment of shock. It wouldn't be like a where was I when Kennedy was shot moment. It really wouldn't be like, oh, it wouldn't be for me. I like the first question that would go through my mind would not be, well, how did he die?
Yeah.
You know, it wouldn't be that. It'd be like, oh.
My first question would be, how long do I have to wait before it's appropriate to play the crab dance? Right? And that's the thing. We could say these things about Biden and also, you know, support one of the most progressive people in the Congress. I think we could hold those two thoughts in our head.
But yeah, see that. So that's kind of my thinking of why I try to give someone like AOC the benefit of the doubt, because she's one of the most popular politicians, period. She's second to Bernie. She's the second most popular progressive. Mm-hmm. Just going off of, like, you know, the stats and all those kinds of things. So
you got like a baseball card?
No, I mean, if you look at the polls.
Sorry, I love it.
But I mean, if you're looking at that, and so that stands to reason that if we're going to end up having anybody that represents anything left of the Democratic Party, it's going to have to be either you trot Bernie back out there again, or it's going to have to be her. That's it. That's it. You know, you don't got too many options in terms of somebody that's viable that could even be that kind of nuisance campaign that Bernie sent out to be in 2016. Mm. So that's kind of one way I look at it. And it's like, all right, how maybe she's kind of weighing it in as, all right, I got to figure out a way to draw some of the libs away from Kamala. And maybe my left flank will stick with me as long as I don't abandon my key policy positions. Because mm-hmm. The left is more policy oriented anyway.
I'm going to change my sign to abandon. No, really good points. I mean, the fucking thing is, dude, we're all so far away from these facts, from the meat being made, dude. We have no idea how that sausage is being made, and we wouldn't know if AOC were making those deals. I just hate it. And I hate basing all of our arguments off of things that nobody knows.
Yeah.
Not Oliver.
I would like to be a fly in the wall and see what kind of conversations are going back behind the scenes. Because, I mean, some of the speculation, it strikes me as outlandish, but it'd be and that's why it would be shocking to see. But if you're thinking, because the way they're framing it as if AOC's in these back meetings with Nancy Pelosi and whoever from Biden's administration and getting like tongue lashed into submission, and that's why she comes out soft. And I'm like,
are we not doing phrasing, Anthony?
Oh, yeah.
Holy moly.
That's my one per stream.
I'm sweating now. All right. And that's the show, folks. Thanks for tuning in. That's it.
Or the old Animaniacs. You remember that one? Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.
But yeah, I mean, that's kind of what I've seen people say out there is like, you know, she gets browbeat into going ahead and to having all this kind of friendly rhetoric towards the Democratic establishment. And I'm like, it doesn't really make sense to me. I mean, it's really that's what's going to get her to back down. I mean, they did try to go ahead and oust her from her seat. They threw money in against her campaign, and she beat the shit out of them. So is she really that intimidated?
No. Well, Anthony, that seems like a seed we're going to go ahead and have to track here. And I think this has been that's awesome. A perfect time to wrap things up. Anthony, you've been a great guest. We've invited you here in the spirit of building leftist unity, strength, and power. And I've had a great time with you. So thank you so much for joining us today. You've been great. Thanks again, buddy.
Awesome. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll see you soon. Peace and solidarity, brother. All right. Next time, bud. And that was Anthony. That was Anthony. Hey, YouTube. You're watching a clip from my Twitch channel, twitch.tv/iDanSimpson, where you can follow for free and subscribe for only $5 a month. Thanks for watching.